Hi and welcome to Nursing School Explained. Today I'd like to go over respiratory medications. This seems to be a topic that a lot of times is kind of confusing to students, and but when we really think about the mechanism of action of a medication, really represents its physiology and the physiological response that it will enhance or inhibit in the body. So I have written down here some basic terms that hopefully will help you be able to dissect the mechanism of action of these medications and then understand how they work, and so also how they're indicated and why they would be used in the treatment of certain respiratory disorders. So first of all, I just wanted to review inflammatory mediators. You might remember from your physiology class all the different cells that help us in providing inflammation when we are battling infection, disease, allergies, any of those things in the body. And some of those mediators I've written down here. So those are neutrophils, you know, those are the number one defense. Then we also have mast cells, macrophages, leukotrienes, T cells, histamines. Now remember, these are only a few of the inflammatory mediators. There's a lot of other ones, but these are the most important that we will apply here to the respiratory medications. And then other principles here, and this not only pertains to respiratory medications, this pertains to cardiac medications as well. And so whenever you see the word adrenergic, think adrenaline, think sympathetic nervous system and fight or flight response. So adrenaline, adrenergic response, sympathetic nervous system. Where cholinergic pertains to the parasympathetic nervous system. Okay, so whenever you see these terms, adrenergic or cholinergic, you know that they are working either on the sympathetic or parasympathetic nervous system. And then in addition, medications can be agonists or antagonists, or they can be against something. So an agonist helps to promote the natural response by occupying the receptor site. Remember that most of the physiological mechanisms that take place in our bodies is kind of like a key and a lock mechanism. So only certain keys will fit to certain receptor sites and be able to initiate a response. So an agonist is basically a chemical or a pharmaceutical mediator or response that we're trying to elicit. So when it's agonist, it helps to promote or agonize that response. Where an antagonist, as you can imagine, does exactly the opposite. So it blocks the receptor sites. So when we don't want something to happen, when we want to inhibit certain things from happening, that key and lock to match, then we want to give an antagonist, because that pharmaceutical, that medication then will block that receptor site as basically like a fake key, so the natural response cannot occur or is inhibited. And then there's also medications that start with anti, and they are basically just means that it's against something. So kind of similar to antagonist, but almost like just a different terminology that is used. Now, another graph that I've drawn out here, over here, is basically beta 1 and beta 2 and then alpha, because there's beta 2 adrenergic receptor blockers, for example, alpha adrenergic receptor blockers, or beta cholinergic. There's all kinds of different combinations. But remember, beta 1, we have one heart, so beta 1 always pertains to the heart. Now we have two lungs, so beta 2 always pertains to the lungs. As I've drawn out here, the heart is beta 1, beta 1, one heart, beta 2, we have two lungs, so that pertains to beta 2. And then this here is an alpha turned on its side. Alpha means blood vessel. So this would be the structures of the blood vessels flowing throughout the body in this little graph here. So beta 1, heart, beta 2, lungs, alpha pertains to the blood vessels. And that for the blood vessels, it mostly means, are they dilating or constricting? Are they having a sympathetic or a parasympathetic nervous system response, and then the mechanism of action can be easily identified. So back to our respiratory medications. So there are a variety of classifications there. This mostly applies to asthma, but they can also be used in conditions such as chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, emphysema, maybe cystic fibrosis, or for acute respiratory disorders such as bronchitis, where there might be some acute inflammation, not chronic like in asthma, where the patient might benefit from a short course of one of these medications. So let's look at that. So number one, I've written out SABA, and SABA stands for short-acting beta-2 adrenergic agonist. Okay, so very short-acting. So beta-2, lungs, adrenergic, sympathetic nervous system. Okay, so basically this binds to the beta-2 adrenergic receptors, therefore it relaxes the airway smooth muscle and causes bronchodilation, right? When we have a sympathetic nervous system response, when we need to get ready to fight or flight, when we need to get ready to run away, we need to be able to dilate our bronchioles by allowing more oxygen exchange, because our muscles will need that oxygen for the flight or fight response. So therefore, short-acting beta-2 pertaining to the lungs, adrenergic sympathetic nervous system agonist, it's going to help to promote that natural response by relaxing the smooth muscle airways and causing bronchodilation. And really the only SABA there is albuterol. I'm sure you've heard about it. It's the most commonly used inhaled medication. Now I've written down here OPND, which is onset, peak, and duration, because later we'll compare it to some of these other medications. So albuterol, the onset is 5 to 15 minutes. Its peak occurs at 2 to 3 hours, and it lasts for about 4 to 6 hours. So this is something that we need to keep in mind whenever we're doing patient teaching regarding these medications. How soon can they expect this to work? Now, classification number 2 is ICS, which are inhaled corticosteroids. And you might know that steroids always battle inflammation. So now looking back at these inflammatory mediators, so which ones in particular do those inhaled corticosteroids inhibit? So for inhaled corticosteroids, they decrease airway inflammation, but they work on multiple inflammatory mediators. So they don't just pick out neutrophils or mast cells or leukotrienes. They work on multiple mediators, which is why they are the most commonly used inhaled anti-inflammatory medication, because they work on a variety of different cells, therefore inhibiting that inflammatory response that causes bronchoconstriction and then causes problems for the patient. And these inhaled steroids, just like any steroids, usually end in "-one". So an example would be beclomethasone, fluticasone, just like your corticosteroids, your PO would be your prednisone, for example. They all end in "-one". And if you can remember these endings of these medications and connect them to the classification, it will be much easier for you to remember and kind of classify them, and then only memorize the drug category rather than memorizing all the individual medications, because there's just way too many out there. So number 3 medications would be ALABA. So you can see it's very similar. The only difference is it's a long-acting beta-2 adrenergic agonist. So it's exactly the same thing as up here, except that it's longer acting. So the mechanism of action is the same as the SABA, but it's longer acting. The example here would be salmeterol, again ending in OL, which is pretty typical for these adrenergic agonists. Now we already know that beta-2 applies to lungs. Adrenergic fight or flight adrenaline pertains to the sympathetic nervous system. So it does exactly the same as the albuterol, where it binds to those beta-2 adrenergic receptor sites, relaxing the bronchial smooth muscle and allowing for bronchodilation so the patient can breathe easier. Now looking at onset, peak, and duration over here. So onset is 1 hour. You can see it's longer than up here. The peak is 1 to 5 hours and the duration up to 24 hours. So it's long acting, right? Long acting, 24 hours, compared to short acting, 4 to 6 hours for duration up here. Now, number four would be anticholinergic medications. And we already talked about cholinergic, meaning that it pertains to the parasympathetic nervous system. I'll move back over here. So cholinergic pertains to the parasympathetic nervous system, and anti means against. Now, why would we want to block or counteract the parasympathetic nervous system? Now think about it. If we again are in a fight or flight response, we want that sympathetic nervous system to kick in. Cholinergic or parasympathetic nervous system is in charge of rest and digest, right? When we need to flee from a danger, there is no need for rest and digest. All the blood flow needs to go to the important organs, the heart and the lungs and the muscles, so that we can run away from the danger. So anticholinergic medications, anti meaning it inhibits the cholinergic receptor sites in the airways. So now we are inhibiting the parasympathetic nervous system from kind of slowing everything down and constricting the bronchioles so we can rest and digest. And when we inhibit the cholinergic response, it also brings us bronchodilation. So bronchodilation here is the end effect in SABAs, LABAs, as well as anticholinergics, but they work in different ways. So anticholinergics working on the parasympathetic nervous system, basically just blocking those receptor sites so they don't have a chance to cause bronchoconstriction, because that's what they would do for rest and digest response. And an example for an anticholinergic respiratory inhaled medication would be Atrovent or ipratropium. You probably have heard that before as well. Now in comparison, the onset peak and duration for anticholinergics, so onset is 1 to 3 hours, the peak is 1 to 2, and duration 4 to 6. So you can see it's very similar to the albuterol in terms of the duration, so it'll last about the same time. Now, there are certain medications that can be given to patients that are used in combination. And one of the ones used very frequently in the emergency department is called a duo-neb. So duo, two medications by nebulizer. And that's always a combination of albuterol, a SABA, and the Atrovent, the anticholinergic. So they both combine to work together to agonize the sympathetic nervous system and antagonize the cholinergic system so that bronchodilation can occur on both pathways. Remember that every organ has innervation from sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system receptors so that they can work either to speed things up or so slow things down. Now, number five here, leukotriene antagonists. So you can see here, leukotrienes are one of those inflammatory markers we reviewed earlier, and they are basically a very specific, they respond to very specific inflammation response. And so these leukotriene antagonists, they do just that. They block the receptor sites for the leukotrienes, so which usually would cause inflammation, and therefore they antagonize that. So they decrease the effect of the leukotrienes and cause decreased inflammation. And that would be specifically a desired response in patients with asthma, where there's a lot of underlying inflammation and other respiratory conditions that have inflammation at their core. And an example of a leukotriene antagonist would be Singulair or Montelukast is the other, the generic version of it. Now then further, we have mast cell stabilizers. Again, mast cells are different inflammatory mediators, and when we stabilize the mast cells, then again we decrease inflammation. So they're again very specific to those specific inflammatory markers. And an example would be chromalin sodium. And then in addition, as if this wasn't enough already, we have certain combination medications. And these combination medications usually consist of an ICS, an inhaled corticosteroid, and a LABA, a long-acting beta-adrenergic agonist. The most commonly used one is Advair. That's that purple discus that you might have seen in the clinical setting. And it consists of salmeterol, which is our LABA, and fluticasone, you know, our OWNs, are our inhaled corticosteroids. And then inhaled corticosteroids also come in low, medium, or high doses. So depending on the severity of the patient's asthma, they'll be on the strength, basically the more severe the asthma, the higher strength or the higher of a dose the patient will need. Let's see. So I hope this has clarified the medications for you. Now, when we think about asthma, think about that the patient will always need a SABA, which is also called a rescue medication, rescue. So this is something that the patient should have with them at all times. And depending on the severity, so maybe all they have is allergies in the springtime, and when everything is in bloom, when they go outside, they need that albuterol with them, otherwise they get short of breath because this inflammation starts. But if this is somebody who is, let's say, allergic to dust mites or dogs, and now they have a dog, or some other have some other allergen that's basically year-round that requires the inflammation in their lungs to be controlled on a more regular basis, then they'll be on an inhaled corticosteroid in addition to a rescue medication. Now, if this is somebody who, let's say, has COPD, emphysema, one of those other chronic lung disorders, where now we need to have longer acting bronchodilation, then they'll usually be on a LABA and an ICS, so they'll be on something like Advair. Now, this is definitely nothing that nurses need to worry about in terms of prescribing, because it'll always be up to the provider to find the most fitting medication for the patients. But keep in mind, it is very important to understand the mechanisms and how they work. And if you know the mechanism of action, you will always know how they work, what response they initiate in the physiology, and then you can apply it. So I would recommend that you memorize this: adrenergic, cholinergic, agonist, antagonist, as well as the receptors, beta 1, beta 2, and alpha. That way you can kind of combine these terms and know what's going on to kind of dissect the meaning of these respiratory medications. Thank you for watching. I appreciate your time. Please share this video if you found it helpful and subscribe to my channel at Nursing School Explained. You can also follow me on Instagram to make sure you get the most recent updates as well as my latest videos. Thanks very much. See you next time.